Good morning, everyone. Lovely to see you. And again, just to reiterate one announcement that Emma made about next Sunday evening. It'd be great if we could have lots of Langside folk here. At least more than those that are coming from the other churches would be good. So if we can make an effort for that, it would be brilliant. And we look forward to that. So, as you come into the church every Sunday over the past number of weeks, you'll have seen a row of pictures taken from our Unravel series. And I think this is probably one of my favorite ones from the list. It's hard to really get it in full Technicolor up on the big screen, but when you see it as it's been produced, it's really evocative of the situation from the reading that Linda has just read to us. I don't know if you've got a favorite from among the list out there, but that's certainly one of mine. But before we get into the story, I want to introduce you to a word. I don't know if you've met a word before, and you'll have met this before, metanoia. It's a word that we find in the New Testament, in the Bible, and that's the English version of the Greek letters. Have you heard that before? Yeah, some heads. Why don't we all say it together? Metanoia. One, two, three. Metanoia. There you go. That's your first Greek word of the day. You know, it's often associated with the term repent in the Bible. But actually, it's much bigger and broader than some of the ideas around repentance that we've heard of. There's one way of thinking of it, an opening of the understanding that leads to transformation. It's not just about an intellectual choice or decision that we make to change our minds about something. It's much more than that, and it involves more than just the cognitive abilities that we have. I changed my mind one time, at least once. I want to show you a picture of my first car. Now, this is not it, but this is exactly the same as it, okay? Did anyone have one of those? Do you know what it is? A what? No. No, it's not a Trabant, Colin. Thank you very much. In fact, I'd love one of those. It'd be great. Yes, Douglas, well done. It's a Simca 1100. It was a used car, bought it back in the 70s. Let me tell you a little bit about it. It was advanced in design, featuring a hatchback with folding rear seats, disc brakes, rack and pinion steering, an independent front and rear suspension using torsion arms. The engine was slanted to allow for a lower bonnet, and the engine, gearbox, and suspension were carried on a subframe to allow the unibody to be relatively unstressed. The body was welded to the frame, not bolted. And here's the thing. It was reportedly studied closely by Volkswagen when they were designing their Golf. See, I was ahead of the time. I was living away from home in a flat, and there was a big car park outside, and my Simca 1100 sat in the car park. And that's about all it did, really. It didn't go very far. It was terrible. I got my first ever bank loan from the bank to pay for it from a friend of a friend who was dabbling in car sales, used car sales. First mistake. And it went sometimes, but that was usually after the mechanic had twiddled with it, and then it stopped again. Terrible car. It's probably worth many thousands of pounds now, but I had a metanoia experience, a change of mind that transformed my way of living, and I managed through dogged determination to convince the guy who sold it to me to take it and give me my money back. And that was something. Paul had something, or Saul had something of a metanoia moment in the reading that we heard this morning. But before we get into the guts of that, let's just remind ourselves a little bit about the scene that we see in Acts. We first meet Saul in Acts chapter 7, and he's almost introduced as an afterthought. Here's the situation. A young man called Stephen, one of the seven that had been chosen by the disciples to help with the practicalities around looking after all these new believers in Jerusalem. Church was growing exponentially, and there was lots of practical issues to be addressed. Stephen was one of those, but he was also full of the Holy Spirit, and he went around preaching and convincing people about Jesus being the Messiah. He got into a bit of bother at the synagogue of the freedmen, probably a synagogue where Jews from beyond Jerusalem and the wider Mediterranean area would come and meet. There's probably lodgings there for them to stay in, a place for them to hear the reading of the Torah and the teaching of the commandments. And they entered into an argument with Stephen, and they saw they couldn't win. And so what they did was they got some other people to give false testimony against Stephen, that he was blaspheming against Moses and God. And that meant he had to be brought before the Sanhedrin, another one of these lovely words from the New Testament. The Sanhedrin, and that was the supreme religious and judicial body in the land of Israel at that time. It consisted of 71 men who met in the temple daily, and they were the final authority on Jewish law. And so Stephen had to stand in front of them and listen to false witnesses give an account of his speech or his preaching. And Stephen had to answer them. And you can read his answer, his defense, in Acts. He began with Abraham, telling Israel's story of how God had been with his people and over the centuries, right up to the time of Jesus. Now, there was a lot in this speech that members of the Sanhedrin could probably have nodded in agreement with. However, Stephen emphasized the resistance that the elders of Israel had shown towards God by rejecting the people God had raised up to lead them. And then came a pivotal moment in his speech, an inflection point where Stephen makes it personal. Now, you can imagine if you were a pal of his and you'd snuck into the back of the auditorium, or maybe you were listening through an open window just outside, and you've been cheering him on, you've been hearing the points he's been making. Yes, drive it home, Stephen. And then Stephen says, "You stiff-necked people with uncircumcised hearts and ears, you're just like your fathers. You always resist the Holy Spirit. And you're sitting outside the window, your heads in your hands. Stephen, what have you done? If you came here to defend yourself and persuade the elders, you've just lost. The game's over. Almost. It gets worse." He goes on, "Was there ever a prophet your ancestors didn't persecute? They even killed those who predicted the coming of the righteous one. And now you've betrayed and murdered him." That was it. That was game over. The crowd were incensed. They rushed forward, grabbed Stephen, dragged him out of the city walls, and started to stone him. And in the midst of this great dramatic scene, the writer of Acts makes this incidental side point. He says, Meanwhile, the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. There he is. Saul has been placed right there at the execution of Stephen. And as Stephen is dying from his injuries, we're left in no doubt that Paul's presence is no coincidence. For we read, "And Saul was there, giving approval to his death." The narrative continues to describe a great persecution that took place in Jerusalem. And in verse 3 of chapter 8, Saul, we read, began to destroy the church, going from house to house, dragging men and women and putting them in prison. And Linda began our reading then by telling us that he was breathing out murderous threats, setting off to Damascus to hunt down people belonging to the way. They weren't Christians at this point. They hadn't been called Christians, but they were part of the way. Saul, where did all this come from? In an autobiographical moment, he states in Galatians, he says, "You've heard of my previous ways, my life in Judaism, how intensely I persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people and was extremely zealous for the traditions of my fathers." And that language has led some scholars to suggest that although Saul, as a Pharisee, was taught by one of the more conciliatory teachers of the Pharisees, Gamaliel, it looks like he was influenced by one of the other factions, the more extreme wing of the Pharisaic movement. And in order to understand what was going on in Paul's mind at this time, although that maybe is an impossibility, perhaps there's a little hint here. We can appreciate that some held a view that in order for God to fulfill his promises to Israel and restore the kingdom, it required purity on the part of his people. A purity arrived at by any cost. And so the stoning of Stephen is set within that context as a purging of all that was standing in the way of what God had promised to do. So Saul was not acting on his own. Something going on within the religious group leadership in Israel at this time. And he was intent on persecuting followers of the way. After Acts 19, we see a very different Saul. And we have to conclude that something extraordinary must have happened. We're told again in our reading today that he went straight to the synagogue in Damascus and began to preach that Jesus was the Son of God, and his preaching was so powerful, we read, his proofs that Jesus was the Messiah were so convincing that the Jews in Damascus, basically they were dumbstruck. Extraordinary. The very same thing that happened with Stephen back in Jerusalem when he was arguing with the synagogue of freedmen, it's now happening to Saul in the synagogue in Damascus, unable to answer Saul's convincing argument. But in Saul, we see this astonishing U-turn. The one who approved of the execution of Stephen and was hunting down followers of Jesus becomes one himself, from persecutor to preacher. And scattered throughout the letters of the New Testament that have been written by Paul, we see this amazing shift in his thinking. A metanoia has happened. He had been putting people in prison for their allegiance to Jesus, and yet in Philippians he tells us, you know, he makes it clear to the palace guard, "I'm in chains now for the Messiah." He was party to Stephen being dragged out of the temple, as we mentioned, and being stoned. And we read in Acts 21 that the crowd seizing Paul dragged him from the temple. And while they were trying to kill him, the commander of the Roman troops ran out with some officers. People stopped, and the commander took control, took him back to the barracks. And Paul tried to explain to the people something of who he was. He said, I persecuted the followers of this way to their death, arresting both men and women, throwing them into prison. I even went to Damascus to bring these people as prisoners to Jerusalem to be punished. And he told a story to this crowd, and they raised their voices and shouted, rid the earth of him. He's not fit to live. So he wasn't getting very far with that crowd. So the persecutor becomes the preacher, becomes the persecuted. And yes, we have to ask what accounts for the dramatic change of direction in his life. Now, we've heard part of the story today. On his way to Damascus, he's confronted with some kind of mystical experience. There was a bright light and a voice, and it knocked him to the ground. We don't know if he was on a donkey, if he was walking at this point, but he fell and he heard the voice and he answered, who is it? Interesting, Ananias, when he was called, knew who it was. Saul had to ask, and he got an answer. The one that he had been persecuting was really Jesus himself. Incredible experience. And I don't know if anyone here this morning has had a Damascus Road-like experience. Probably very few have. But for Paul, for Saul, later to be called Paul, this was the moment when something changed. A turning point. His beliefs up to this point, his view of God, the Jews, the non-Jews, his mission in life, his reason for living, all came under the spotlight, and a change occurred. It appears there was a suddenness to this change, although as we follow Saul's story, there are gaps. When it's suggested he went off, for example, he said himself he went to Arabia for 3 years. We're not sure what he was doing. Other times he disappears from the scene. We don't know where he is. I like to think Saul spent time reflecting on his life, thinking about his life as a Pharisee, growing up in Tarsus, becoming a Pharisee, hunting down Christians, and now here he is, a follower of Jesus himself. How did he get here? What has changed in his thinking? What has brought him to this point? And certainly that sudden encounter with Jesus was a moment of great change. He spoke later on in Corinthians, if you remember that verse, that if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. And we can see that in Paul's life himself. He's speaking out of his own experience, his own metanoia, if you like, of transformative change. I wonder if you've had to reflect on your own beliefs, on what you were taught as a little child in the church. And as an adult, you've come to maybe a different view of the Christian faith, of the Christian life. We've been thinking about unraveling over these past number of weeks. And I wonder how much of what you started off believing in your Christian life has unraveled to a point where you're seeing the world, seeing God, seeing others in a different light. And perhaps now you've got more questions than answers. I think, like Paul, we're in a period of discovery as we grow and develop in our faith. Some call this experience one of deconstruction. taking something apart, examining it before deciding if it's worth keeping or if it needs to change or if it needs to put back together again. And over the years, when David was our minister here, he spoke often of different points of view, different conclusions that he had come to about things that he had once believed. And so I thought at the tail end of our reflection this morning, I'd ask David to come up and sit with me here at the front. We'd just have a wee chat about this, because we didn't really get much of an opportunity to stop him in the middle of a sermon and say, well, hold on a wee minute, how did you get from there to here? What was going on for you? How did you manage to arrive at this point? So David, why don't you come up and we'll have a chat. Do you want to sit over? Can everybody hear me?
He's a lot louder than me.
So, David, Richard Rohr suggested that when we look at our faith life, there's almost like three approaches we can take. There's the building phase, you know, from early life when we're introduced to God and faith. And then there's this idea of the deconstruction. There's the challenging of that faith. And then there's the rebuilding of it. Can you tell us just briefly a little bit about those early days and how you came to believe in God?
So when I was young, my parents sent me away. They had to get rid of me for the summer because I wasn't at school. And so they had to find things for me to do, otherwise I'd be with them. So they had to get rid of me and they'd send me on all kinds of holidays. A holiday they would send me on was Scripture Union Camp. And so for a number of years I used to go to Scripture Union Camp, which is kind of evangelical Christian organization. And it was, in those days they were for boys. So it was a kind of boys camp and you did all kinds of boyish things, played games and whatever. But there was a heavy kind of religious input there. And so you had a wee worship in the morning and a worship in the evening. And there was here is the gospel and an attempt to get people to respond to the gospel. So I went along to a couple of these camps and I quite enjoyed the camps. They were quite good fun. There was lots about that was good. And at first, not necessarily altogether sure about the religious bit. But eventually, one particular camp I was at, I was 13. They were talking about Jesus. They were talking about the whole thing about God. And suddenly for me, it kind of clicked into place. And so there was this invitation to respond to God, to realize that Jesus had come into the world because God loved me and was showing us what God was like, and I should try and make some response to that. So the opportunity of saying a prayer at a wee service. So I did that, and my life flipped completely around. It changed my life. Nothing has ever been more dramatic than what happened on that day. I suddenly got this feeling that God was here. Rather than, oh, maybe there's a God, maybe there's not a God, and leaning one way or another, it was, something's happened here. There is a God. God is near me. God is real. And to some extent, you could put a full stop and say, nothing has changed since, because I've always known that and I've always believed that. The thing that changed, that did change though, in dramatic ways, as time went on, was that I never doubted God. I never doubted the importance of Jesus. I never didn't want to be associated with Jesus. But there were things that were explained to me about the Christian faith that didn't seem to be to make much sense. And not only not make much sense, it just seemed to me plain wrong. So there came a point in my life, and it was a good long, long time after, when I really seriously started to think about these and thinking to myself, is there a way of thinking of that in a different way? Or is the way things have been explained to me just simply not correct? And I began to change and reassess and come up with different conclusions. So it didn't change my belief in God. It didn't change me wanting to be a follower of Jesus, but it made me question some of the things that I'd heard in church. A lot of it was great, but there were certain things that I thought, that just didn't seem right to me. And so I decided I had to take my heart in my mouth and start asking these questions.
What age would you have been when you started exploring these questions?
Because I'd eventually, reluctantly, decided to become a minister. I didn't want to be a minister because my dad was a minister, and he and I were very different, and he was a well-respected minister in the Church of Scotland, and I thought, I can only be worse than him, so I should do something else. So I wasn't sure about that, but I went through that phase, eventually went to university. When I got to university, everyone was desperate to tell me about all the things I shouldn't believe, and there was a lot of skepticism at the university. But even when there, I kind of resisted thinking about too many challenging questions. So the honest truth, it was more when I came out of university and actually started out as a minister, dealing with people, dealing in churches, dealing with people's experiences, it was the life, if you like, that made me want to ask questions as some of the things I've been told.
And I know that music has played a large part in your life. And we were talking a number of months ago and discovered we were probably at Green Belt the very same year. I went for 2 years when I was a teenager, hitchhiked from Northern Ireland all the way down to, I was in Bedfordshire at the time. And Green Belt's a large arts and Christian festival, music festival. And you were playing with a band, I think. I don't remember
it. Would be.
But there were some, I know we shared when we spoke of some of the big names that were there, the Randy Stonehills, the Larry Normans, those After the Fire. Yeah. Don't you remember them?
What's our favorite?
Yes. You'll love After the Fire, yeah. After the Flood as well, isn't a big favorite at Langside.
So in terms of music and faith, you know, how has that impacted on your life and this journey of discovery and of exploration? I know you weren't expecting that question.
I sure wasn't.
No.
In terms of music and faith. The only thing I can think to answer about that was that the job, the band you're talking about, was probably just a job. And one of the things I did when I got into music was there were bands and there were Christian bands. So Christian bands, their job was to play in churches, and other bands played in other places. And so we were possibly one of the first ever Christian bands, because it so happened. We weren't actually setting out to be a Christian band, but we were all Christians in the band. And we thought, well, why don't we play in pubs where everyone else play? Why should we have to always play in church halls? And so we started doing that, and we got involved in the kind of secular music scene. And at the time, I mean, that might sound very boring to you all, but at the time, that was unheard of. You know, it's interesting, if you're a Christian artist, you don't have to paint Jesus all the time. But if you're a Christian musician, then you have to sing songs about Jesus all the time. Why is that? I don't know. But it seemed that it was like that at the time. So it was a different way of getting involved in the music scene. We were one of the first bands that did that.
Was that pre-university or...?
Just post.
Just post, right.
Just post.
So you've left university, you've now become a minister, and you're starting to realize that everything you were told as a child about God and about the Bible and about Christian life isn't necessarily the way it is.
Yeah.
Is there one example you can give us of maybe something you believed that you were challenging in your own thinking?
We've got to be quick, and we have to be quick here, but so we'll have to shorten this as much as I can. But one classic example would be hell. I remember talking to having a conversation with one minister when somebody said, one of us said something about hell, and he snorted or something like that, and I said, so you don't believe in hell? And he turned to me and he said, he was a lot older than me, and I was his boy sort of thing. He says, Davey, he says, I don't believe in a God that loves you so much he's going to send everybody to the bad fire. And that was literally, that was the expression he used, we're all going to the bad fire. That started me saying, it wasn't the first time I'd ever thought about that, but that was one subject. Because the Christianity I was sort of brought into was one that basically said that God hates us. God doesn't like us. God is sending us all to hell. We've made mistakes. God won't accept that. So we're all going to hell. If you believe in Jesus, then you can escape. If you trust in Jesus, then God will love you because of that. Otherwise, God won't love you. And I thought, that seems to me to be monstrous. And I don't believe that's the case. I believe, and I do believe now, that God's default position towards us all is love and not hate. I don't mean that we don't get God angry or we don't disappoint God. I'm sure God can get fed up with us the way we all live our lives. But the idea that God hates us and is going to send us to hell is just a concept I can no longer accept. Another thing that goes along with that is what some Christians say is this bit about the Bible being the inerrant word of God. So the Bible is infallible. You can't ask any questions of the Bible. And I just think that is just patently nonsense. Jesus is the greatest example of someone who came along and asked questions of the Bible. Jesus was the guy who came along and said, "You have heard it said." And then Jesus quotes the Old Testament. And then Jesus says, "But I say to you," and he says something else, something well different. Jesus was updating, if you like, the words of the Bible, because the Bible are words from thousands of years ago, written by people in that time with that mindset. And not everything that they said is worthy of God. Not everything is accurate. So in other words, you read the Bible, you've got a God who wants everybody killed in a battle, spare nobody, kill them all, and a God that loves you so much, even the hairs of your head are numbered. And the idea that you have to accept that God is both of these things, God is not both of these things. And when you were suggesting that I would come up with a biblical example, I quickly thought of Noah's Ark. Everyone knows the story of Noah's Ark. Here's three ways to understand Noah's Ark. One way is to say, this is a lot of rubbish. How could Noah's Ark be true? Therefore, it's rubbish. Therefore, the Bible is rubbish. Therefore, Christianity is rubbish. And that does it for a lot of people. It keeps them out of faith. Noah's Ark, you believe that, get a life. So that's one view. The other view is to say, no, Noah's Ark's true. It's in the Bible, so it's true. So it really happens. Or it really happened. My view on that is, I know at the end of the Noah's Ark story, God says, I'll not do that again, but sorry, even once is too much for me. If a God of love can destroy the whole world and say, oh, don't worry, I'll not do that again, sorry, this God of love is no longer a God of love. So to take, and the two by two and all, we're taking that literally. I can't take it literally. So that seems like the choice we've got. Either it's a lot of rubbish or you take it literally. If you were to ask me about what I think happens with the story of Noah's Ark, my view would be to say, I think a long time ago there was a really big flood. You see it in other civilizations and in other religions, they talk about this. I think a long time ago there was a huge flood. I'm sure it didn't cover the whole earth, but it must have seemed to for people like that. And in those days, people had the view that God did everything. So if it was raining or sunny or a flood, God did it. So let's suppose there's a huge flood. People then say, how did that happen? Well, God did it. And then they think, wait a minute, why would God do that? Oh, God must have been really angry. Well, why would he be really angry? People must have been really bad in those days. Remember, nobody right in this story was alive at the time when this is supposedly happened. So we're going back into history. God must have been really angry. People must have been really bad. So then there's the flood. Well, maybe it'll happen again. No. God's promised not to do it again. And then that will be okay. This is a story that people made up to kind of describe as best as they could understand what happened. My particular view is there was no Noah's Ark. And that seems like quite a big thing to say until you understand, that the Bible is a collection of stories. They're not all meant to be taken as literal stories. They're stories told for a particular time. And we know that if there was a flood thousands of years ago, God didn't do that, no more than God makes it rain or shine today. This is the weather we're talking about. But long ago, people had to make up stories to try and fit something that they knew about that just didn't seem right. And I just don't think that's a very good explanation. The Bible begins with one family, goes to one extended family, goes to one tribe. This is God. God's interested in two people. God's interested in that family. God is interested in the tribe. God's interested in the nation. But through the Bible is a development where we realize God's interested in everybody. God's love is for us all. There's no chosen people. We're all loved. We're all important. We're expanding, and we learn as we go on.
So it must have been quite scary for you as a minister, having to rethink your theology, your view of the Bible, and so on. And just very briefly, if there's somebody here this morning and they're going through a similar process of deconstruction, if you like, what could you say to encourage them?
So what I would say to encourage anyone who is, and I understand that, because I think the Christianity I grew up with had in the back fear. There was a fear that if you get this wrong, if you don't believe the right stuff, then God will not accept you. So it's very scary to say, well, I don't think I believe that, because what if that's the one thing God does want you to accept? What I would say is that the breakthrough moment for me was to realize that the important things, the true things, are Jesus. Jesus is the Word of God. He's the one we need to concentrate on. God is real. It's all real. But sometimes we say things, we exaggerate things that are not actually helpful. And should we get it wrong? And I'm not asking people to believe with all the things I believe in. You choose what you want to believe. But what I think is we have permission from God, because God's position to us is not one of anger or I want to find an excuse to snuff you out. God loves us. God wants the best for us. God wants us to have the best life we can have. God wants us to be in relationship with God. And if we get something wrong, it's okay. And if I make a mistake somewhere along the line, and it turns out one day there was a Noah's Ark, and then I go up and there's Noah waiting to speak to me. Okay, that might happen. Who knows? That might happen. I'll be very surprised, but it might happen. And it's kind of like, oh, that's the end of me then. No, it's kind of, it's okay. I think we're free. And the most important thing for me is that the God I believe in, which is obviously the same God all along, is a God of love. And I feel secure in asking my questions or raising my doubts in front of this God of love, whereas I wouldn't have in front of the other God who's waiting to snuff me out. So in other words, I would say God is big enough to accept our questions, to understand. When we're genuinely trying to seek the truth, God wants us to do that. And we're in good company because Jesus did the same thing. Jesus asked questions, and Jesus suggested to people that, see, everything you read in the Bible, it might not be quite right. And if it's good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me, and it should be good enough for us.
Thanks, David. I think we could carry on asking you questions. We could open up to the floor.
We're all
just beginning.
But we'll not do that this morning.
Thank you.
All right. Say, in terms of Saul becoming Paul, I think he would have agreed with you, because remember what he said in Corinthians, there's faith, there's hope, and there's love. But the greatest is love.
Yeah.
And we've got to, I think, remember that, don't we? And accept that that's true.
That's number one.
Thanks very much. Why don't we give David a round of applause?